What's going on there, guys? My name is Matt, or Chewy, as most of you all know me as, and we are back today with another prepared or P3D video for you all. This time, a little bit different than what we did before, a much longer flight, should I say, than the last video we did. If you missed it, we flew a Ryanair 737 from Verona to Palermo, and today we are the other side of the pond. We are in North America with some new scenery that I've not even touched yet, new scenery which I am very, very excited to show you all and to fly with. And we are at Washington Dulles on the ground at the second as United 340, and we will be flying to San Francisco KSFO, which will be very good indeed. I have no idea why GSX seems to have arrived and the only cargo that we're taking are two of these crates. That's a little bit awkward. That looks a bit weird, but hey-ho. We're on gate Delta 7 at second, or stand Delta 7, should I say, which is the stand that this actual flight departed from yesterday when I was looking on flight radar. And we are in the Gold Star Textures at new United Merger livery, which just looks absolutely phenomenal. I mean, before we get in the flight deck, you can go and have a quick look down here, and I can just show you guys just how awesome it is, because it really does look very good indeed. Okay, right, with any further ado, let's get into the aircraft and get things running. So we've already got the door page up here just because we've got things loading in. But before we can do anything else, I really need to set up the fuel, because I've not done that, the fuel and the payload. So we'll go to payload first. Today our zero fuel weight is 184.5. So I'll pop that into there like that, and the load level, there we go, is 53.6. I'm not too sure why, if that's such a... I don't know what's going on with GSX. I'll just leave it to do its own thing. Whatever. And then fuel-wise today, we are taking 44466. There we go. So that can get loaded into there, and that's 30.5%. So that's the fuel and the payload loaded in. I'll leave this third FMC on the doors page for now, just because I like to close it from there. And that's absolutely fine. Right, before we go any further, let's do the pre-flight checklist. So oxygen, let's go over here and test that. Okay, oxygen is tested and reading 100%, that's fine. Flight instruments, so heading, well, we haven't actually got anything on here at the second because the ADIRUs aren't going, but we'll just tick that for there now. And that's the checklist done, the pre-flight checklist done. So before we do anything else, let's get those ADIRUs started so I can turn them to on even straight away. We'll also arm the emergency lights here. Fuel pumps can go on. I don't think we've got any fuel in the center pumps. We shouldn't do. Yep, no, we don't have anything. If I bring that up, there you go. You should see it. So we don't have any fuel in the center pumps whatsoever. And we've got an even balance on the left and the right, 22.2 in each. What else can we do now? Packs can come on as well whilst we're here. And then we shouldn't be on the ground for too long, so I might as well start the APU up. Just as a disclaimer, I don't do everything completely perfectly and in the right order or anything, so if anything is wrong or not in the right place, please don't judge me. This is just kind of what gets me going quickly and gets things started. Also, apologies as well for the FPS counter that's in the top left-hand corner. It suddenly appeared out of nowhere, and I'm just being a noob, and I don't actually know how to get rid of it. I should really check. I think it's to do with NVIDIA. But hey-ho, I mean, I guess it shows you guys what my FPS is like in the flight deck and in the simulator, so maybe it's kind of helpful, I guess. Right, anyway, let's get the barometric pressure set as well. Of course, in North America, they use inches instead of hectopascals. We'll swap over to the first officer seat whilst we're here and put that in as well. I'll probably switch back to hectopascals and cheat a bit. But for now, we'll just stick it in inches, and I'll be proper about it, shall I? I'll also put meters on there as well. Whoopsie daisy, because I don't know why I just like to have meters on in the 777. But I won't worry about clicking any of these things at the minute. I was going to fly on Vatsim, but I decided to fly offline just because I wanted to record this video and I wanted to make sure that everything else went okay first. Right, let's get the FMC up, shall we? And waste no time there. Unlike the 737, I won't be using FS2 crew for this, so it'll just be me controlling the aircraft, which means we'll get out, get off and into the air a bit quicker. Again, which is why the procedures may be in a weird order, because it's just me doing it. Right, we are at KIAD, Washington Dulles. I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly. And we're on gate Delta 7. I don't know if it'll take that. Nope, it won't. That's fine, I'll just get rid of it completely. and then we can set the inertial position there, and the screens should come to life. All right, we'll do a route request. You can see all of the flights that I've done here. I need to get rid of these and kind of refresh everything so it's nice and clean. But here we go. There's the company route we're doing today to San Francisco. So we will wait for that to do its thing and load in the route. Runway today, we are using 30 out of Washington, which is not very far away from where we are currently on the ground. Right, passengers are boarded. Baggage loading is in progress, apparently, according to GSX. So that was way too quick. I'm not too sure why, but whatever. Okay, so the route uplink has loaded up. So that's just going to do its thing now and get itself sorted out. Take a few seconds to do that. I'll just clear that out of the way. And we'll pop in runway 30 there. And today we are Uniform Alpha Lima, or United Airlines 340. That's our flight number. Activate and execute. Okay, before we go and do the performance initialization, I like to do the departure out of the airport first. So let's find runway 30. That's what we've got selected today. And today we are taking the McRae 2 departure. Now, again, if I bring up good old Avlasoft, there we go. You should be able to see it here. For some reason, actually, oh, wait, no, is it working now? Yes, it is. Okay, it wasn't working earlier on. So here we go. Here's the ground charts for you guys. One of the big feedbacks that some people gave on the last video is that they wanted to see more of the Avlasoft EFB, so I'll try and show you a bit more today. So here's a full chart of the ground. You can see runway 30 there. And here we are on gate Delta 7. And now if I go onto the departure section, we can see here, oh, actually, no, you can't see it because it's not on the screen. Don't worry. But we're taking the McRae 2 departure, which will take us to McRae there. I'll try and incorporate some more of the Avlasoft EFB over time. But for now, I just thought I'd show you that. Anyway, back into the flight deck and into the performance initialization page. So we will request all of that information. We exported all of the information from PFPX, so hopefully it should all load in okay. And we will see. It does take a few seconds to load in. There we go. So we will accept that. That's absolutely fine. Cruise altitude is 380. I'm not too sure what United use for cost index, so I've just gone for 100. So apologies if that's not completely correct, but hey-ho. Step size is actually going to be zero. So we're not going to be doing any steps today whatsoever. It's only about a 5-hour flight, I think, in total. So that's absolutely fine. Now, again, I'm not too sure if United use D-rates or not. The kind of config that I've got set up for the 777 right now is actually the British Airways one, and I've just been using it on most of the 777, so not realistic in that sense, but I mean, it's just the way that it is. So I need to sort it out at some point, so I really do apologize about that, that it's not completely realistic, but hey ho. Anyway, it's going to be just a normal takeoff, no D-rates as I've just mentioned, with an assumed temperature of 67 degrees, which gives us a climb 2 rating there. We'll go to the takeoff page. It's a flap 15 takeoff today. Yeah, which goes into there. Center of gravity can get popped into there. And there are our V speeds today. Takeoff weight is 229.6. Takeoff speeds have been deleted. That's absolutely fine. I don't know what the noise abatement departure procedure is, whether I need to put that in. Again, I've not checked the charts because I'm a noob, but I'm doing these kind of things quickly. It's no excuse for me to do so, but there we go. That's absolutely fine. So I can leave the takeoff reference page on there, and that read that our V2 speed was 145. So we will pop 145 into the MCP. We're going off runway 30, so I'm going to bug in what I think is the runway heading for now. And we'll double check that once we get down there. And because we're flying offline, I don't have to worry essentially about initial altitudes or everything. So I'm just going to bug myself up to 380. Again, apologies if this is kind of rushed and not professional and not realistic. I'm just getting through things quickly so we can get in the air and I can have a look at this amazing scenery. Right, we'll pop the second FMC on the legs page there like that. And that's pretty much good. The only thing that I need to do from the legs page, actually, if I bring that up, is go on to route data, and we'll do the wind data request as well from Active Sky. And that will just take a few seconds to do its thing, but it shouldn't be long whatsoever. Again, it's only a 5-hour flight today, and we won't be doing any step climbs, so I don't need to enter them in onto the legs page. There we go. Everything's loaded in, so we can just execute that, and it will pop us back onto the legs page. Perfect. Right, flight directors can go on. Auto brake to RTO, LNAV and VNAV can be armed as well. And I'll make sure that everything else is on. We finished fueling, so the seatbelt signs can go on. That's not a problem whatsoever. And then I think we're ready to go. Let's have a look outside again. It looks like boarding has completed. So we will take away the jetway and move that out the way. And then we can actually prepare for pushback and departure. Now, we're going off runway 30, so I actually want my nose to go to the right. We don't need to worry about starting engines before pushback. And so here comes the little guy, ready to go there. Okay, so whilst we're getting ready to prepare for pushback, we can do the before start checklist on the lower ICAS. So flight deck door is not modeled, so we can select that. MCP is set. Takeoff speeds are set as well. The CDU pre-flight is completed for now. Trim is still zero because we've not got the hydraulics up and running yet, so that's fine. Taxi and takeoff briefing. Well, we're going on Delta taxiway initially, then across Zulu, and we'll carry on Zulu to the holding point for runway 30. So there we go. Taxi and takeoff briefing is completed, and then the only other thing we need to do is pop the beacon lights on. So that is the before start checklist complete. I'll pop us back onto the door page, and we can actually close all of these now and arm all of the doors. So I'll close these whilst we're here. And whilst they're closing, we'll go over to the ground connections, and I will remove the wheel shocks, and that automatically removes the ground power and everything as well. So we will arm that, and then hopefully in a second all of the doors will be good to go. Whilst that's doing that, we can actually start the hydraulics. So we'll do that whilst it's doing its thing. There we go. It looks like everything's closed. That's absolutely fine. I'll kind of stick us back onto the menu page there for now. All right, that fault light's extinguished. So I will start the left electronic hydraulics whilst GSX is locking the gear outside. Okay, fault light's gone on there. So we can pop C1 and C2, both electric and air as well. And that's absolutely fun. Once hydraulics is set, we'll go over to the flight controls page. There we go, she's just there. I haven't flown the 737 in a while, so apologies if I'm a bit slow with things. And we will set the trim. Is that the right way? Yes, that is. So the trim today is 3.0, apparently. So there we go. There is the trim set. Okay, we are ready to go and good to push back. So we can release the parking brake. Excuse me. We'll go to the engine page, and then I don't think there's anything stopping us pushing back and starting up these engines. So we'll head over to the overhead. Start number two. Now, unlike the 737, you don't need to wait for 25% N2. You can pop in the fuel control lever at 2%. So I'll shut up for a second and let you guys listen and watch as the number two engine comes online. Okay, there's starter cutout. We'll just wait for the engine to stabilize. Just absolutely sounds incredible. It really does. There's nothing that I love more pretty much in P3D than just hearing those GE90 engines start up. Incredible beast. Okay, let's have a look down at our engine indicators. Everything looks nice and stable. So on that, we can start number one engine. Again, looking down here at our lower ICAS display, as soon as we see 2%, pop in the fuel control. Zoom out a bit as we finish the pushback, so parking brakes can be set. And once again, we'll listen and watch as number one engine comes online now. absolutely amazing. It truly does look phenomenal. Okay, apparently my recirc fans are off. I didn't even realize that. Silly of me, that's why we have the upper ICAST display doing its thing. Okay, so engines have stabilized. So what we can do now is I'll take away the engines page there and we'll set flaps. So we're going flaps 15 today. 1, 2, and 3. And then you can watch as the flaps come down. There we go. Right, GSX has cleared off. They've wished us a good trip, so we are clear to taxi. Still a couple of things we need to do. Won't take us long. Okay, flaps 15 is set. Now the APU can come offline because we've got the engines fully up and running. That's absolutely fine. Doors auto, that's all good. So we'll go back onto the flight controls page and just do a very quick flight controls check. So full left, full right, full up, full down, and then the rudders as well, full left and full right. Right, back onto the checklist and before taxi checklist. So anti-ice is not required here. It's 11 degrees centigrade at the second. Recall is checked. That's absolutely fine. Flight controls just been checked and the ground equipment is clear. There we go. Now, before I actually taxi, I want to do something because I've completely forgotten how to do this. But there is a way I can get the compacted engine view on this middle ICAST, on this upper ICAST display. And I need to remember how to do it. I think I do it like this. But for some reason, my mind's telling, like, forgotten how to do it. Actually, I think I need to get rid of it onto there. There we go. That's how I do it. And then I simply move it across into the middle. And now, out of nowhere, we've got the compacted engine view. Well, the compacted view on the upper ICAST, which just looks a lot better. Again, before we head off as well, I'm going to pop terrain on here. And I'll also put airport information on there. And that's absolutely fine. And I'll pop airport on here and we'll pop the weather radar on when we get closer. Right, runway turnoffs can come on. Taxi lights can come on as well. And as far as I'm aware, we are clear to go. So let's release the parking brake. Check to the left. Everything is clear. We'll spool up the engines. And start our taxi. So again, that taxi briefing again, we're going to be heading down Delta, which is where we are now. And then just up here, where my mouse is kind of trying to point, we'll be making a left onto Zulu. And just following Zulu round onto the holding point. It's really not a very long taxi whatsoever. The beautiful GE90s. This is also the first time that I'm seeing this scenery right now. I have no idea what it's like on performance or anything. It really is the first time that I'm seeing it. And so far, it is impressing. I'm really looking forward to seeing what San Francisco is like as well. I've heard very good things about that scenery. Very good things indeed. Okay, I have no idea what's going on with this guy in front of me. It looks like a vehicle out of Star Wars. Luckily, he's risked it and got away with going in front of us there, but... Well, has he not? He looks like he's going to go straight through my wing, but whatever. That's ground AI traffic for you, I guess. But we're a bit slow, so I can increase the throttles a bit. One good thing about flying in North America is that I don't have to worry about transition altitudes. Because they're 18,000 feet here in the US, which just makes life a lot easier because that's what automatically enters itself in to the FMC of this aircraft. Okay, so a left turn here onto Zulu. Yankee is the taxiway just over there as the signs read. And then we just simply follow this along. I haven't flown this aircraft in a while, so I keep forgetting just how crazy powerful the engines are. And you really have to keep on top of things, otherwise they you know, you have to keep an eye on your ground speed, otherwise they really can get ahead of you without you even realizing. Let's have another look outside, shall we? Absolutely lovely airport. It wasn't that expensive either. I'm surprised that I haven't got any more scenery from Flightbeam before. Of course, as always, I will... Whoa, hello, where am I taxiing? Oh my gosh, that's what I was talking about. That's a perfect example of what I was just saying. But yes, what I was going to say is that I will, as always, leave a some links down in the description so you guys can pick up the scenery if you do like the look of it. Apologies for my awful taxiing there. Right, before takeoff checklist. Okay, that's coming up on my navigation display. I don't know why, but that's absolutely fine. It's probably because it's selected on there. Oh, I know why. It's because it's selected on there. That would be why. Okay, I'll close that down for the second. I'll try and show you guys that properly and redo that section where I show how to bring up the compacted view on the upper ICAST display once we get into the air. Because I know that not too many people exactly know how to do that. So once we're maybe at cruise or something like that, I'll show you guys how we do that. Anyway, here's runway 30 just ahead of us. So we'll stop any more thrust and start to slow the aircraft down. And we will hold short. There shouldn't be any aircraft, so we'll pop the TCAS on. Pop the weather radar on as well now. Actually, we can keep going. There's no point in us stopping with no aircraft, you know, around. We're not flying on VATSIM or anything. We might as well continue onto the runway and keep that kind of momentum there. Right. Taxi lights can go off, strobe lights can come on, and the landing lights can come on as well. I'll keep the runway turn-offs on. So you make the right turn to meet runway 30. Okay, again, we might as well not lose this momentum. We can clear ourselves for takeoff because we're flying offline. So let's keep the aircraft going. I will move the throttles up. And hit Toga. Here we go. Aiming for 85. Thrust is set. 80 knots is checked. This thing is just so fast. It's absolutely incredible. I love it. It's such a beast. It feels so heavy. V1. There's V1. And there is rotate. So pulling gently back on the joystick for a nice smooth rotation there. That click was the auto brake moving off. Absolutely gorgeous initial climb here. It really is a phenomenal airport. I'm going to stick the autopilot in straight away because I really want to show you guys the scenery. I haven't seen it myself, so I'm also being a bit selfish in that respect because I want to have a look at the airport as we depart out of here. Look at that wing flex. Completely forgot about the gear because I'm so careful looking at all the scenery, so I'm an absolute idiot. Hashtag blame Chewy. But gear's coming up now. We can call for flaps 5. Got the green arrow there indicating that our speed's coming up. Flaps 5 is set. What a beautiful area. Right, we'll go flaps 1 now as well. Again, without any noise abatement departures or procedures or anything like that. We don't have to worry about speed restrictions by the looks of things. We can go straight to 250 knots on our climb out of here. Right, now, I'm going to put us on a manual heading. And we'll go with heading to select. And we'll make that right-hand turn now and head towards our initial waypoint. Obviously, in real life, you would have ATC vectoring you and making sure you're on the right line and everything, but that's just the McRae 2 departure which is doing that. So I'll pop us on a manual heading of 348 now until we get closer. You can see the vectors coming up there. And then what we'll do is we'll pop this to the top. And you should see McRae come to the top of the list now. And I can pop us back onto LNAV. So a nice smooth turn. Unfortunately, it looks like the weather's absolutely crazy or something, and we're bouncing around all over the place. I don't know if we can, yeah, we can kind of see the airport behind us. It does look great in the distance as it leaves the view. And off we go, already reaching 8,000 feet, and you can see that climb right there, 3,250 feet per minute at the second. We'll match up our heading as well. I'm also going to extend the range on here just to match up with everything, so we've got the same on both navigation displays. Right, at 10,000 feet, we can take the lights off now. So that's fine. We've got the beacon, the nav, and the strobe lights on a bit below 10,000 feet there, but it doesn't really matter too much. It looks like we've got a headwind, which is kind of not helping us at the second, but that's absolutely fine. And now that we reach 10,000 feet, you'll see that the speed should jump up as well. So the rate of climb will just drop back a bit just to allow the engines to spool up. So have a look on the upper ICAST displays as the engines spool up once more. And we will accelerate away from Washington. Just thought I'd start recording again and bring you back into the flight deck at the second, because I don't know if you've noticed, but there is some absolutely crazy turbulence hitting us every now and again. So I've kept the seatbelt signs on for now. We're only just passing through 20,000 feet or 6,300 meters, and we had some crazy turbulence. Of course, as soon as I stop, as soon as I start recording again, it seems to have disappeared. But you can already see that headwind that we've got here if I bring up the navigation display a bit larger. We've already got that 90 knot headwind, and that's exactly the direction we're going to be heading in. So it looks like we're going to have a heavy headwind the entire way, and it's only getting higher as we get higher as well. So that's a bit annoying. It's going to slow the flight down very slightly. I'm not too sure how much, but I'm just going to cautiously keep the seatbelt signs on for a few more seconds, I think, just until I'm absolutely positive that we're clear out of the way of that turbulence. Okay, welcome back to the flight deck once again, ladies and gentlemen. We've just reached top of climb, and we have that monstrous headwind, as I talked about on the climb there. So that's going to slow us down a bit, but not to worry. I thought, as promised, that I would basically show you guys once again how to get that compacted screen on the upper ICAS display, because I did it kind of in a rush earlier on, so I thought it would just help you guys to show you a bit clearer now that we're in cruise and we can kind of chill out and I can explain things quickly. So at the second, I mean, if we actually head over to the first officer's seat and let's move a little closer in here, you can see we've got all of these buttons here which give us different controls, and we can pop them onto different screens. So we can pop anything on the left inbound screen there, like hydraulics and everything like that, and change all of these around. It's usually on the navigation page, which is what we'll leave it on. And the lower center screen, again, you can change it around and pop different things on their hydraulics gear, blah, 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 all of those things. Now, what a lot of people like to do is to have the engine information with the oil temperature, the oil quantity and everything also on the screen as well, but they don't want to have anything on that lower ICAS. And that lower ICAS is actually used quite a lot in the real aircraft for, you know, they can contact ATC and everything. Unfortunately, it's not actually modeled in the PMDG version, but you can get messages from ATC and everything on this lower ICAS. So the way that you can pop it in that compacted view, the first thing that you need to do is to take it off here, so you have nothing on the lower ICAS display whatsoever. And then if we move across over here and you have a look at this inboard display section here, if we move that across to the right by just right clicking it once, it will switch to ICAS, and the lower and upper middle ICAS displays here won't show anything. But the inbound screen here, or as I call it, the captain's navigation display, will show the engine information. Now, if we click engine here, you'll see once again that it comes up with information in the lower ICAS. If I turn that off and just click this button here and pop it to the left inbound screen and then click engine, you can see now that we have got the compacted view here of everything we want. But we don't want it on this left-hand screen. We want it on the middle upper ICAS here, the upper center screen. And so we just left-click it to put it back into MFD mode, and then the inboard display will switch back to the navigation display, and now we have the compacted view on the upper ICAS. You can switch back to the lower center button here and still pop, you know, onto other screens if you need to and have a look at anything else, or just leave it blank like I do. So there you go, guys, just a little quick demonstration to show you all how you can put that compacted view up on the upper ICAS. Okay, welcome back to the flight deck once again, ladies and gentlemen. We are now how long? 4 hours and 24 minutes into the flight. Not far away now from reaching our destination of San Francisco. If I bring up the FMC, you can see top of descent is in 154 nautical miles. So it's about time that we planned our arrival. I'll pop that down though, and again, very quickly bring up Avelosoft EFB. I've already calculated where we will be arriving, and the active runway news at the second in San Francisco is 28 left, which you can see right at the top here. So we will be taking the Risti 4 approach or star arrival with Echo Charlie Alpha ECA as our transition, which is actually the final waypoint in our flight plan. And that will take us to Cedes down the bottom here in the middle of the screen. And then we'll go direct from Cedes to Archie and then onto the ILS DME approach to runway 2 left. So there's all of that information there, if you will. So let's take that off the screen and pop that into the FMC now. So departures and arrivals, ILS 28 left is just what we selected there. And it will be the Risti, I just missed it there on the second page, Risti 4 approach with ECA as the transition. And then also into the ILS approach, we'll have Archie as our transition there. Now we'll execute that. And if we bring up our navigation display, if I just make that a bit bigger, if we go to the legs page, we'll see just there that there's actually a discontinuity. If I go to plan mode, you should be able to see it. Go, so step there, and then you'll see, if I bring that range ring down, you'll be able to see a bit better. From Cedes there, there's actually that break. There's a discontinuity there. So the way that we can get rid of that is just to pop Archie into our scratch pad. I've completely done the wrong thing. There we go. And just drag it up to where the discontinuity is. And you can see that the magenta line is now connected. So all of them are in place. So we'll pop that back there. And that is the star completed and our arrival ready to go. So the next thing that we can do is actually go into the VNAV page. We'll head over to the descent page and then forecast. And we'll do a forecast request and just get Active Sky to bring up all of our winds information. And that will just load in and just help the aircraft make sure that it knows what it's doing on the way down. And just give us a more accurate kind of arrival time and everything. Right, so we can load that in and you'll see everything get filled in here. It's such a good feature where you can just incorporate Active Sky to do this. It saves you filling out the numbers directly yourself, which in all honesty, I probably wouldn't do. If I was doing it, you know, just manually like that. Anyway, before I go any further, let's head back to the legs page and move all the way down to the runway. So runway 28 left. And what I like to do is I just like to create some range rings around the airport just to give myself a good bearing so I know where I am. So we'll do a 4-mile range ring, a 10-mile range ring, and then also a 15-mile range ring, nautical miles. This is, of course, around the airport. So that can go into there like that. Perfect. I'll set that back on the progress page for now. Actually, no, what I should be doing is this. I should be popping that in there. So go to the init ref page and it comes up with the approach ref. And we can see that we're taking flaps 30 today. So our VREF speed will be 137. That's absolutely fine now. I don't need to enter in any ILS frequencies or anything like you do with the 737 because the 777 is lovely and it calculates it all for you. We'll go with auto brake level 2 today. I could probably get away with auto brake level 1, but we'll go with auto brake level 2. There's absolutely no harm in it whatsoever. Transition level is already set at 180, so that's absolutely fine. And then the other thing that I need to do is have a look and set our MDA decision height, which today, according to Avelosoft, is 212. So if I just hold this down, I don't like the way that this happens in the 777 where you have to kind of hold it down with your left mouse click to get down there. You can see that I've already just gone way too far on it, so now I have to drag it back up again, and then you have to kind of fine tune it when you get closer. So 212 is what I said, so there we go, and that's absolutely fun. And then also, if I bring up Avelosoft, I can have a look and see what our altimeters will be set at, and they will be set as 300. So let me pop that in as well. The QNH is 1016 in hectopascals or 3000 in inches. Whoopsie daisy, click the wrong button there. Now I've got to wind it up again. 29.99, there you go. So you can see it there. That's now entered in, and everything is fine with that. On the ground, it's going to be 17 degrees temperature at the second in San Francisco. Surface winds are 270 at 14 knots. So we're going to have a headwind, nice 14 knot headwind, which will certainly make sure that we're slowed down, ready on to finals. Visibility is absolutely fine. And as I said, that QNH, that pressure is 1016. Right, I think we are pretty much there. Everything else is good to go. I'm not going to worry about winding down the MCP altitude yet, because we've still got a while to go. 119 nautical miles until top of descent. So we'll let the aircraft carry on a bit further, and I will join you guys once we get down. Okay, ladies and gents, we are a little further down the road now. That's not quite the politically correct quote, but hey ho, whatever. And as you can see, we've now got 28 nautical miles until top of descent. So we will do our descent checklist. Let's move a little closer, shall we? So you guys can see the text a bit better. Recall, let's do that. Press the recall button. Recall is checked. Absolutely nothing there. Notes is fine. Auto brake today is going to be level 2. Landing data, it's going to be at 30. VREF 137 and minimums will be 212 feet. And the approach briefing is completed, as we talked about a little earlier on. So there's the descent checklist completed. Whilst we're here, we will also wind down the MCP altitude to our final approach fix of 1,800 feet. Again, we're not, I'm going to all the wrong views now. What am I doing? Oh my gosh, I'm causing a fool of myself. There we go. So we are not going to be using any ATC or anything. I'm doing this flight offline. So I'm just going to be controlling my own descent, and that's our final approach fix. So everything is good to go. We are ready for our descent. I'll pop that back on the progress page. I'll show you guys top of descent just like I did in the last video, and then I'll probably join you maybe just as we're going down through about 10,000 feet or so onto our final approach. So I'll see you down there.
People say that this feeling's gonna die, but I'm the one who knows that this heart just can't lie. But I won't stay silent. I won't stay silent, I won't stay silent.
Okay, welcome back. We are just about to go through 10,000 feet. This is the second time that I've been going through 10,000 feet. Unfortunately, my simulator crashed just as we were on our final approach, pretty much. So this is the second time I'm actually recording this right now, which is a bit of a pain, but hey-ho, it's whatever. Anyway, 10,000 feet, we'll pop the landing lights on. I'll leave the nose lights off for now and the runway turn-off lights on. Everything else is good. Passenger signs is on, and we've done everything there. I'm just going to keep an eye on that speed, because our VNAV profile has gone a little off here. So I'm just going to make sure that we can pull ourselves back in check. I'll deploy some speed brakes just to help keep our speed down and make sure everything is okay. But hopefully the simulator is all right now. I'm not too sure what happened. I think it was just loading in the simulator, in the scenery even, and it just decided to die on me, and the sim crashed. So hopefully it will be okay now and everything will work properly. There we go. We're back at 240 knots, so I can stow the speed brakes once again. And you can see on the navigation display that our VNAV profile is coming back in check absolutely fine. So a bit of a pain in the ass when things like that happen, but hey-ho, as I'm sure most of you guys will know out there, it is part of the parcel when you're a flight simulator guy. Right, we'll go back onto VNAV now, because back within 100 feet of our VNAV profile, so I trust that it's going to sort itself out. Again, just keeping an eye on that speed because it's starting to creep towards 250, so we'll bring out some more speed brakes once again. I probably should deploy them slowly, but it's just so much easier to press the forward slash key. I will be getting some new gear soon, which I'm not going to release on the stream now. I'll talk more a little bit about it in a bit maybe, but yes, we've got some cool new gear coming its way, which will help me in the flight simulator world. Anyway, enough of that. We'll head our final approach course now. I have 283 for runway 28 left, which you can see here now, and you can see those range rings in full view as well. The 4 nautical mile one, 10 nautical mile one, and the 15 nautical mile one as well. 28 nautical miles to go. We don't have to worry quite yet about anything like flaps. We're all good there. I think the localizer's come alive though, so I can arm the localizer on the MCP anyway, and you can see it here, that white magenta kind of diamond shape there. So not too long before we make that right hand turn. Now I will bring in the range rings on our navigation displays just so we can keep an eye out on things and make things a bit better. I don't like a cluttered navigation display, as most people from my stream will know. Hopefully it won't crash this time. If you're listening to me talking right now, you will have known that it won't have crashed, at least not on our final approach anyway. So hopefully I don't have to record this for a third time. I'm not too sure what happened and why it crashed, but I'm looking forward to seeing what this scenery is like on the ground. Should be good. Let's have a look outside, shall we? Whoopsie daisy. Aircraft just loading in there. I think it's just taking its toll on the memory, and maybe that's why we're having issues. Let's go and have a look out this view. It still looks like absolutely phenomenal scenery around here. Really does look very good indeed. Right, back in the flight deck. Let's not mess around anymore. 22 nautical miles to go. So what I'm actually going to do now is I'm going to call for flaps one and just make sure that we're okay with that speed. You can see that the localizer's now come into that pink, magenta, diamond, and we'll start to come back. And as soon as flaps one is indicated, the speed will hopefully drop back as well. Or will it? That is the question. Go on to approach hold, and then I guess we're going to have to do manual speed intervene there, which is absolutely fine. And I'll bring our speed back to flaps one speed. The glide slope is also caught, which is perfect timing. So now we are fully established on the localizer and the glide slope. I'm going to deploy some speed brakes just to help with our speed coming back now as we make this turn onto 28 left. Everything is looking good. Go outside again and have another look. Absolutely beautiful view. I'm not too sure what airport that is. Again, I'm pretty awful at geography, so apologies that I'm not telling you all these crazy landmarks and everything that we're passing by. I just suck at those kind of things, I guess. Right, 60 nautical miles to go. Frames are going low. Again, that's not really surprising with an airport of this kind of caliber and this size. Frames may be a little dodgy, but hopefully we'll be okay all the same. Speed is coming back nicely, so I will take flaps 5 now. Look at that view. Wow. FSFX packages again doing its thing. Still haven't got the runway quite in sight, but we are fully established on the localizer and the glide slope. So what I can do now is actually reset my MCP altitude to our missed approach altitude, which I believe is 4,000 feet today. And this is why I love these range rings, just because they really help me out to give me some good spatial awareness, so I know exactly where I am and how far I've got left. We're absolutely fine. We've got no rush to call for gear down or flaps 15 or anything. Of course, getting that gear down will really help with our speed, give us a bit extra drag along the way down. Cabin is secure, as it says on the upper ICAST there, just with perfect timing. So that is all good for me. We've still got another 12 nautical miles to run. Speed's come back now, so I'll bring the speed brakes in, and we can keep that speed going down. Nice, easy rate of descent. Everything is looking really good. I'm very excited to see what this airport is like. It's kind of annoying that we've got this misty haze in front of us, which is disturbing our view of what it will look like on the ground. But hey ho, once we get a bit closer, I'm sure it will come into view properly. See what we can see outside, shall we? It really does look amazing out there. 7-knot headwinds, so that's absolutely fine. Just what we wanted. We don't want anything too crazy that's going to completely like drag me off guard. I think we can just about see the runway ahead of us there. So what I'm going to do now, with 3,000 feet, we'll call for gear down and flaps 15. There's the gear, and has my simulator crashed again? No, it hasn't. We just had a little freeze there for a second. Gosh, that scared me. Whew. Okay, we're good. We're good. Right, speed can come back once again now. Hopefully with the gear down, we'll have some extra drag. And I'll keep going with the flaps. So flaps 20. Radio altimeter. And we'll go to the init ref page. Oh, I'm already on the init ref page. So 137 is what we want. So 142 is going to be our final approach speed. So we'll go down to that now, and then I'll call flaps 30. Okay, so we are full on flaps. The runway is in sight now. Speed's coming back nicely, so I can arm the speed brakes, and we can also turn those nose lights on. So everything is good for landing, and on that note, we'll do the landing checklist. I've done the approach checklist. That's absolutely fine. I should have done that earlier on, but that's okay. Landing checklist, speed brakes, landing gear, and flaps landing checklist is complete, and we are good. Just passing through 1,500 feet a second. So what we will do is we'll take manual control from here, and I will try and guide this absolutely gorgeous aircraft down myself. There we go. It gives us the warning tone. That's absolutely fine. So I'm going to remain light on the controls. Hopefully I won't float it or anything. I'm just really excited to see this airport and see exactly what it all looks like, because it's supposed to be very, very good scenery indeed. So I'll just remain light on the controls. That headwind's slightly going up at the second. That's absolutely fine as usual. Keeping an eye on the flight directors on the primary flight display, and also trying to keep a good visual reference. 1,000 feet is checked. Looking at those white and red pappies as usual. Speed is looking absolutely fine. Can bring the nose very slightly up. Don't want to go too below the glide. And we're a little to the left as well. RAAS doing its thing and telling us what runway we're approaching. That's exactly the runway that we wanted, so thank you for that. Okay, there we go. Now a little more centered and back on that glide path a little, so that's fine. The frames are absolutely all over the place right now, so I do apologize about that. I didn't really quite realize how much of an impact this airport would have on my computer, but hey ho. Does look absolutely stunning. I'm thoroughly enjoying this approach, I have to say. Right, try and bring that nose down a bit now. Still fine on the glide path. Everything is looking good. That's 100 above minimums.
Decision height.
We will continue. Two whites, two reds, exactly what we wanted. Bang on in the middle of the runway as well. Let's hope that I don't float this landing, because knowing me, I have probably jinxed it.
50, 30, 20, 10.
Back on the stick. Oh, that was a bit hard. It's fine, we're down. Well, I didn't float it. I kind of planted it in the ground. I tried to pull back on the stick nice and carefully, but hey-ho, we're down on the ground. That's the main thing that counts, right? 70 knots, auto brake can be disarmed. 60 knots, the reversers can be stowed. And there we go. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to San Francisco. What a gorgeous airport. Okay, so we'll take the next high-speed exit. And after we do that, we'll clear up the aircraft and work out where we need to go from there. Oh my gosh, the frames here are just destroying my computer. Right, autobrake can be disarmed now. I can bring in all of the flaps. The APU can come online as well. I've already done all of the lights. Guys, watch the flaps come up, and then we'll work out where I need to go to park. Shouldn't be too difficult. Okie dokie. Right, let's keep the thing moving, and then I'll have a look on Avasoft DFB just on the other screen. I won't bring it up because there's absolutely no need for it, but I'll work out where we're going from there. So I think the taxiway just to our right here is Bravo. I can turn these flight directors off as well. That would probably help me out a tiny bit so they're not distracting me or anything. So what we're actually going to do is we're going to take a right here and carry on Alpha. And if I bring up GSX, hopefully it won't crash on me. That's the number one thing. So we're going to go to, if we go to gate, we're going to go on gate Foxtrot 87, if it will let me. Okay, it will let me go on 86. Actually, let's go on Foxtrot 84. That's absolutely fine. Foxtrot 84 is perfect by me. That should just be up here. United Airlines is the one that we want, so that's good. It is a gate that United go to. So that is all good. Right, APU is running. Everything's okay. Flaps are coming up. Flight directors are off. I don't think I've forgotten anything. I hope I've not forgotten anything. Knowing me, I have. We're okay. And I will carry on along Alpha until we reach our stand. Let's have a look outside again and have a look at the scenery. It's pretty bad on frames, but hey-ho, it looks incredible, right? And it's not really too surprising after a five-hour flight like we've had, if my computer doesn't suddenly like it, I guess. Right, let's keep on going. There's GSX up there, so it's a very easy taxi for us. I'll just try and keep a nice consistent speed. I'm not on the center line or anything right now, so apologies about that. My speed's a little low, but we're all good. Absolutely gorgeous approach into that runway there. Not the best landing ever. I mean, I guess Easy Dock always makes the landing seem kind of a little harder than they actually are, simply because of the shaking effect, but I tried to flare it. At least I didn't float the thing, but I'll stop making excuses now. Speed's still a little low, but hey-ho, we're in no rush. SFO there on those containers. That looks pretty darn cool, if I may say so. Right. So here is our stand of Foxtrot 84. You can see the marshal is there, so I will turn off the taxi lights in the runway turn off so as not to blind him. Keep the throttles in. And then make that left-hand swooping turn, hopefully without stopping. There we go, he's signaling for us. Now, I'm not going to cheat today. I'm going to try and stay centered and not do it in the outside view or anything. Which, knowing me, will be a bigger task than anything else. Nice and smooth. Is it going to stop me just before? I bet it is, isn't it? That will do. That will do. Okie dokie. Slightly off, but that's absolutely fine. So parking brake is set. And The engines can be turned off after 5 hours and 10 minutes. I said earlier on in the video that that would be what we expected and what we wanted to have as our flight time. And that is exactly what we wanted. So there we go. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to San Francisco. Right, seatbelt signs can come off now. And I'll instantly pop in the wheel chocks, which are not in that menu. They are in that menu. I'll set the ground connections in, but I won't use them at the second because we've got the APU running. So that's absolutely fine. Right, seatbelt sign is off. I'll turn the beacon light off now whilst I'm here. I don't know if I'm supposed to turn that off straight away, but I will do anyway. Hydraulics can come off as well. That is all good. Packs can come off. And the fuel pumps can come off whilst we're here. That's absolutely fine. I can leave it in that state. Let's request the boarding. And get the jetway to come to us as well, if they work here, which it looks like they will. And then we can go down once again to this lower FMC, open up the doors, and they can take off the one single container that GSX decided to put in whilst we were in Washington. I still have no idea why it decided to do it like that, but there we go. Right, let's go out the front and have a look. Park very slightly to the right and completely short there. We should be on the 777-23 line there. So that's why I actually like to cheat and have a look at it, just because it makes us a bit more like accurate with our representations there of it. But that's absolutely fine. Okay, it's going to wait for me to open left entry one, even though there's like no jetway attached to it. So we will do that. I'll disarm and open the door. And then whilst we're here, I might as well stick us on the external power and turn off the APU. And then we are all good. So welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to San Francisco. That was a really nice approach, and this really is absolutely incredible scenery. I'm thoroughly, thoroughly glad that I decided to make the decision to do this flight, and I hope you've all enjoyed it as well as my second flight simulator full flight video that I put onto YouTube. So there we go. The containers, whatever they're called, I should know the proper name for them, are coming off, and for some reason we seem to have picked up more in the air, because although we left with one in each hold compartment, it seems that they're taking more out now. So I'm not quite sure how that happened, but hey ho, it's magic, I guess, the magic of flight simulator. Anyway, guys, I'm going to leave it there for the evening. Thank you so much for tuning into the video. If you did enjoy it, please leave a like, comment on the video, and let me know where you want me to fly next. If you've got any recommendations for airports, and if you think I should fly a particular route, please let me know. I do prefer real world routes. So comment in the comment section, even, if you think I should do a particular flight. And also make sure to subscribe to the channel as well. We are very close to breaking 800 subscribers, which is awesome. So thank you very much for that. Have a good night, guys. Cheers.